What is it like and what does it take to capture the world with a camera? Jeffrey Brown has our look at a group of women of vision.
Two boys chasing a kite through the rubble of an anti-government stronghold near Yemen's border. A herder in Norway chanting while tending his reindeer. A full moon hanging above the highway to Mount St. Helens. Three of the 100 photographs depicting cultures far-flung and close to home. In an exhibition titled Women of Vision, National Geographic Photographers on Assignment, part of the Society's 125th anniversary celebration. It showcases 11 women, from veterans of the magazine to several who've completed just a few projects. One of the best known is 39-year-old Lindsay Addario, a Pulitzer Prize-winning war correspondent who's covered conflicts from Iraq and Afghanistan to Darfur and the Congo for National Geographic and the New York Times.
I go in because I think that the story has to be told. Like any journalist who dedicates their life to covering conflict, I feel very strongly that these stories need to be seen by the American public.
Part of that coverage, capturing the daily life that somehow goes on amid violence.
That fascinates me. As someone who is in the middle of a place, I want to bring a different perspective to the person outside and let them see, yes, there are daily car bombs, there are people dying, but at the same time, there is peace going on and there is daily life continuing.
And is there always a moment when you know you've got it somehow?
There's an initial moment where I'm in sheer panic, where I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to tell a story. And then as I become more familiar with it, I understand what I think the poignant moments are and what the most important moments are. And generally, I get to a point where I feel comfortable. And I'm never satisfied, but I at least feel like I have a good grasp on how to tell that story.
In her 14 assignments for National Geographic, 43-year-old Amy Tonsing is focused on individuals and small communities around the globe. Puerto Rico, the Jersey Shore, Australia's Aborigines.
My job is to tell stories about humanity. And in order to tell stories, you have to know your subject. And everything goes back to honoring my subject.
Tonsing researches her subjects through current events in history, but also through novels.
Because novels speak on a very visceral level. They speak on a more sort of emotional, lyrical level, and I think that's how photography works as well. So when I'm about to go in the field someplace, I love to read novels about a place that can really help kind of get my mind going about what's going to work for the visual translation of telling the story.
In 2008, she was assigned to look at the impact of climate change and drought in the Murray-Darling Basin in southeastern Australia. Her way in, find a local farm family and look through their eyes.
I slept in a room in their house for probably about a week. Mm-hmm. And in this picture, I'm along for the ride. And so I'm like, all right, chasing pigs, I'm with you. And then there's a picture. And really that picture is, obviously it's not about pigs.
Not necessarily about drought either, right? I mean, if I just look at the photograph.
No, it's not about drought. It's about people.
At 26, Kitra Kahana is the youngest of the photographers in this exhibition. Her first feature assignment for the magazine was about the teenage brain and behavior. In an Austin, Texas high school, she found a girl's face reflected in the mirror of her parents' truck. Girls getting their tongues pierced. Boys taking video of a boxing match to post on Facebook. At the time, Kahana was just 4 years older than some of the subjects she spent months getting to know.
Were you taking photos all the way through? When do you start?
You start as soon as you develop a relationship with someone and they let you in into their lives. Slowly over the course of the assignment, I didn't have to go to classes anymore or sit in the lunchroom because someone would text me and say, we're skipping school today, do you want to come? Or we're going to this party, do you want to come? And it was really about having the time to slowly uncover it's not the secret lives, but the personal lives of teenagers.
I asked Kahana, amid this exhibition of women photographers, how being a woman impacts her work.
I'm seen less of a threat, and they'll think, oh, that's the face of sort of a a quiet, kind person, not the face of National Geographic, like the media.
Lindsay Addario told us she's had an advantage as a woman working in the segregated society of the Muslim world, where she could see and capture a life largely off limits to her male counterparts. Addario was kidnapped in 2004 in Iraq and then again in 2011 in Libya, where she and three male colleagues at the New York Times were held captive by pro-Qaddafi forces for 6 days before being released. Sometimes readers were outraged at the paper.
How could the New York Times, I'm quoting what you were reading, how could the New York Times let a woman go to a war zone? And you wrote that you found that grossly offensive.
I did find it really offensive. I still find it offensive today because I think that this is my life and I have very set reasons for doing what I do. And I think that if I want to dedicate my life to covering war, that's my prerogative. Why should my gender affect what I do? If I'm capable of doing the same job as a man, why should it matter if I'm a woman?
This showcase of women photographers is in Washington through March and then at venues across the country for the next 3 years.
You can see more of these arresting photos from all 11 photographers. That's on ArtBeat.